Ahoy, classmates. Larry Turner here. I am sure most of you, like me, are finding it difficult to believe that it has really been 40 years since we graduated from the Academy. Where has the time gone? I would like to take you on a journey back in time to those 4 years that we spent together in Annapolis. Of course, that journey began 44 years ago with plebe year in 1970. Remember what was going on in the world back then? Well, first, most of us had just graduated from high school. The Vietnam War was still raging despite President Nixon's pledge when he was elected in 1968 to end the war, and we all still had to register for the draft. In May 1970, four students had been shot and killed protesting the war at Kent State University, and subsequently students at several hundred colleges and universities had gone on strike. Obviously, the Naval Academy was not one of them. And while many male students were protesting the war and the draft, here we were volunteering to serve our country. Here is a list of some of the other things that were going on in 1970. Note the price of gas, the average price of a new car, and how about the average annual salary? Pretty amazing, huh? Our plebe year, of course, began with plebe summer, and plebe summer officially began with our induction day on 29 June. I remember it being a sunny, hot, and humid Annapolis day, what we would soon realize was a very typical Annapolis summer day. Here are some highlights of that day. We arrived in spur coats and ties, or uniforms as the case may be, and lined up outside the LA area and began our check-in process. Remember how the check-in process consisted of a series of stations, each with a different purpose? The one shown here was for signing up for plebe football. We had our last leisurely meal in the mess hall, lunch, rigatoni beef casserole, I believe it was. We then headed to the mid-store, where we were measured and outfitted for the uniforms that we would need for the next 8 weeks. Then we lugged all that gear in a laundry bag along with what little personal luggage we had to our plebe summer rooms. The firsties even seemed to be helpful as we began stowing our uniforms, showing us how to fold the clothing items and label everything with our alpha code. Everyone still remember their alpha code? Late in the afternoon, we gathered in Tecumseh Court and were officially sworn in as midshipmen, all 1,300 plus of us. We also got our first glimpse of Dodo. Remember the little dog that had free run of the Academy grounds our first 2 years at the Academy? We then returned to our rooms, changed into our uniforms, and plebe indoctrination was officially underway. Those firsties that had seemed so helpful only a few hours before were now barking orders at us. It took us a while getting settled into our plebe summer routine. Each Monday through Saturday, the day would begin with pep. Remember Heinz Lenz leading us in all those exercises on Farragut Field? The guy had incredible energy, didn't he? For the remainder of the day, we would attend various scheduled events, marching to them either in platoons or squads, never individually, and singing little songs the firsties had us memorize, like Shave His Belly with a Rusty Razor. What few free periods we had during the day, we spent studying reef points. Remember how we had to have our reef points with us at all times, tucked into the waistband of our white works? Then there was the drilling with our M1 rifles, lots and lots of drilling, learning the manual of arms and how to march in P-raids on Warden Field. Think of the many P-raids we would march in during the next 4 years. We soon learned that mealtime was not a time to relax. We sat at attention, our eyes in the boat, making sure the upper class received their food first, and of course responding to a myriad of questions, especially those regarding our basic rates, all the while holding up empty trays of food for second helpings when the second spell was rung. Then there were the inspections. Myriads of inspections regarding personnel, inspections for uniforms, polished shoes, and regulation haircuts, and room inspections. And finally, there were the plebe hoes that the first class would convene at random times during our free periods, either to further instruct us or to yell at us for our poor performance that day or just to toy with us. How many times did you hear them play that Eric Burdon song, "We Gotta Get Out of This Place," during a plebe hoe? Remember our mandatory all-hands meetings held in Mahan Hall plebe summer? Those were the meetings the administration would attempt to positively motivate us after we had been repeatedly told all day long what screw-ups we were. Here is our plebe year superintendent, Admiral Calvert. What a dashing figure he cut, didn't he? He addressed us during one of those mandatory all-hands sessions, during which he somehow ended up speaking about the Pueblo incident. I've always referred to this as his pine box speech. You will see why in a moment. As you recall, the USS Pueblo was a naval intelligence gathering ship captured by the North Koreans under pretense it had violated its national waters. The surviving crew members were held captive for several months. While the captain of the ship was later exonerated for his actions in surrendering his crew and ship, it became clear that Admiral Calvert had a different opinion. He concluded his speech with the words shown here. And gentlemen, I am confident that if you are ever in a similar situation, that you will come back in a pine box rather than surrender your ship. For me, and I'm sure most of you, it finally hit home what a life and death profession we had embarked upon. Parents' weekend finally arrived, officially ending plebe summer. For us, it didn't come a day too soon. Parents, relatives, and girlfriends arrived to see us finally arrayed in our new tropical white long uniforms, which included any ribbons that we had earned on the rifle and pistol range that summer, as well as our newly earned National Defense Ribbon. Here is me in my tropical white longs with my father. Several functions were held during parents' weekends to both impress and inform our parents. One evening, the superintendent and commandant addressed the parents. My father told me that questions were allowed from the audience after their prepared remarks. One parent had asked Admiral Calvert if he could explain what their son was experiencing during plebe summer. Here was the Admiral's response. When your son arrives at the academy, we immediately take away everything he had considered as a God-given right, and then give those rights back to him one at a time over the next 4 years as privileges. I don't think the midshipman experience could be expressed any more accurately or succinctly, do you? After parents' weekend and before the rest of the brigade returned, we moved our belongings to our academic year company locations. For me, it was 13th Company in the 7th Wing, 7-1. Our three-man room was located directly across from a soda vending machine, so we soon had a steady stream of returning upper class looking for change for the soda machine. With the return of the brigade came a whole host of new requirements. We soon learned that plebe summer was actually a walk in the park compared to what we were now required to do in addition to keeping up our academics. First began the mandatory come-arounds, not because we had done anything wrong, but just because the first and second class had to check us out. We had to memorize three items on the front page and three items on the support page of the newspaper and be prepared to discuss them at mealtime. We were often given special topics to investigate and then report on at the next meal. This may have just been peculiar to our company, but our second class required us to bring funnies to breakfast every morning. Once the football season began, we had to memorize the starting lineup for the Navy football team, both offense and defense, as well as know the opposing team key players and head coach. And we had to post a spirit poster outside our room each week. Finally, once cold weather set in, we had the infamous window closing detail. I can well remember the week our room had window closing detail. We were like walking zombies by the end of the week due to lack of sleep from getting up in the middle of the night to close those blasted upperclassmen windows. Let's talk about academics for a minute. Here was my first semester course load. I had selected an engineering major, aerospace engineering, but I'm sure most of you had a very similar looking course load. The core courses are highlighted here in yellow. Academic year also brought a host of physical requirements that had to be met. Our first swimming requirement actually took place during plebe summer, but would be the first of 4 years of swimming requirements. Coach Higgins, shown here, would teach many of the classes. I swear the man could make it across the width of the natatorium in just one stroke. Then there were the boxing lessons and tests. We had those both plebe and youngster year. Remember how Coach Cloud would look forward to seeing a bloody nose during those tests? Worse than the bloody nose was just to have to don that sweaty headgear, though. Remember how awful that felt? We also had wrestling lessons and tests both plebe and youngster year. I had never wrestled before, so I was normally the guy on the bottom, like shown in the picture, but on my back, just trying not to get pinned. We also had gymnastic lessons and a test plebe year. No, that is not me on the pommel horse. Then we had those requirements that had to be met each semester all 4 years. The physical fitness test, which had included sit-ups, push-ups, and pull-ups, and the mile run. With the advent of the football season, we got introduced to pep rallies and tea court. We sang songs like The Goal's Old and Gnarly, and threw rolls of toilet paper, learned new cheers like the whistle boom cheer, and listened to Coach Forzano predict the team would do us proud. That did not necessarily mean a win, but it did mean a win over Colgate in the season opener. And of course, who can forget the Air Force game plebe year. We were the first plebe class to watch Navy play Air Force at RFK Stadium and then have Liberty in Washington, D.C. after the game. President Nixon was rumored to be attending the game, Remember before the game started when a black limousine with the presidential flags drove down the field on the Air Force side and the Air Force cadets all stood up and saluted, only to see Bill the Goat emerge from the limousine rather than the president? Air Force would have the last laugh, though, as they won the game handily. The day following the game, stories began to emerge regarding some of the shenanigans that took place in downtown Washington during our Liberty. When it was announced that the Commandant had called a special indoor formation Monday afternoon, we knew that it was not a good sign. After berating the brigade for several minutes about the many phone calls he had received about ungentlemanly midshipman behavior, Captain Coogan ended with the following. "Gentlemen, I'm not going to be taking any liberty next weekend, and neither are any of you. The brigade is restricted from all liberty from now until the end of the week. Dismissed." While the drunken mishaps probably involved as many youngsters as plebes, it was us, of course, that received the brunt of the blame. I vividly remember the first class in our company retaliating for their lost weekend by instituting mandatory come-arounds for us for the rest of the week. Academic year also introduced us to tea fights. The Academy Social Director, Mrs. Marshall, coordinated the invitation of young ladies from female colleges across Maryland, Virginia, and Pennsylvania to come enjoy a mini blind date with a plebe during a Sunday afternoon. I can recall the upper class recounting their unpleasant experiences as their tea fights. "How many of you hid in the back of Dahlgren Hall so as not to have to experience who might await you at the other end of the curtain? Or were you one of the more adventurous types and gladly hopped in the line hoping to meet Miss Wright on the other side of the curtain? I'm sure there are even some of you who may have been so lucky as to have actually met your future wife at a tea fight." The Army-Navy game arrived before we knew it. We could have never have imagined all the stunts that went on during the week leading up to the game. We were regaled with feats of plebe spirit from previous years by the upper class and challenged to exceed those feats. Here is the company-winning spirit poster that my room constructed for Army-Navy. Here is a picture of a Japanese torpedo that had been moved from its place in the yard and placed in the mess hall, inscribed with "Beat Army Comets" in white shoe polish. It was just one of the many yard monuments to be displaced that week. I am sure the diggers and fillers, as we affectionately called the groundskeepers at the Academy, did not look forward to Army-Navy week at all. And here is a picture of the bonfire held on Thompson Field the Friday evening before the game. This was a tradition that probably ended well before Thompson Field gave way to the location for the new auditorium. The day of the game meant the bus trip to Philadelphia and then the march into JFK Stadium. The superintendents from each academy had agreed not to disturb the march on of their sister academy. You can see from this picture that Navy ignored this directive for the Whoops march on. The pregame pageantry also included the best of the floats and projects constructed by our class and stationed around the perimeter of the field. However, the highlight of the pregame pageantry had to be the bikini-clad young woman who ran across the field just prior to the coin toss. While Army was favored to win, Navy prevailed 11-7. I was amazed at the intensity of the game. It was so hard-hitting. Navy finished the season with only 2 wins, but the Army win made the whole season. It was the first win over Army since 1967. For us, it meant carry-on until the start of Christmas leave, and the right to receive an Army B-robe for those of us who were savvy enough to have made that wager. Navy's season record, once again, was 2-9. Christmas leave went by much too soon, and we returned to the Academy to face our first dark ages. We quickly learned how accurate that description was. Those often overcast days, the leafless trees, and the occasional snowfall made the granite buildings look drab and dark. One small thing we did have to look forward to was finally having music in our rooms. The one tabletop radio per room that had been authorized by the brigade commander. Of course, the only radio station we could receive clearly was the midshipman run station WRNV. After a couple of weeks, it was time to prepare for our first final exams. The upper class were directed to suspend most of the plebe requirements during finals week, including all mandatory lights out. Remember the box lunches we received at evening meal to take back to our rooms to help us make it through the late night exam cramming? Depending on our exam schedule, most of us had at least a couple days free before second semester began. Not enough time to do much of anything unless you had parents or relatives that lived just a short distance from Annapolis. Here is my course load for second semester. Again, the Core courses are highlighted in yellow. And I've also highlighted the introduction to computing, because looking back, I think it was very far-sighted of the Academy to understand the importance of computing in the future. Second semester went by much quicker than the first semester, as our plebe requirements were now almost second nature. We completed our second semester finals, and our first June week began. The highlight of June week for us was the Herndon ceremony. We gathered at the base of the Greece Monument and began the process of building a human ramp for hoisting a classmate to the top of the monument to replace the Dixie Cup with a combination cap. We did not set any records, but the main thing was that it was successfully done and our plebe year was officially over. No more chopping, no more basic grades, and no more harassment at meals. Our youngster year began right after graduation, when we put on our youngster shoulder boards. Plebe year resignations had taken their toll, though. Of the 40 of us who started plebe summer in 13th Company, only 27 remained. Here is what was going on in the world during our youngster year. I have highlighted the most important event, passage of the 26th Amendment, giving 18-year-olds the right to vote. We would be able to vote in the next election. Our youngster summer program was our first exposure to shipboard life, with a cruise on LPDs, either on a West Coast cruise leaving from San Diego or an East Coast cruise leaving from Norfolk. Those going on the East Coast cruise began their summer program immediately after graduation. Those going on the East Coast cruise had a month of vacation prior to starting theirs. I was on the West Coast cruise. We had a bit of a surprise. The cruise was supposed to have gone to Vietnam, Hong Kong, and Honolulu. However, the Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral Zumwalt, was not aware that a midshipman cruise was going into a war zone. And when he did find out, he directed that the itinerary be changed immediately. Our new ports of call were to be Auckland, New Zealand, Sydney, Australia, and Honolulu. Still not too shabby, of course. Before starting our cruises, we experienced 2 weeks of combined firefighting school and damage control school. This had become a Navy requirement for all shipboard personnel as the result of the tragic fire on the carrier USS Forrestal in 1967. Here is a picture from firefighting school. Remember the infamous firefighting command? Prepare to gooseneck, gooseneck. That became a catchphrase for the remainder of the summer program. Here are some pictures from the West Coast cruise. This is a picture from the cover of the cruise book we each received. Here is a picture of us getting our golden shellback initiation for crossing the equator and international dateline simultaneously. And here is a picture of yours truly on board the USS Duluth entering Pearl Harbor. In September, we returned to the Academy to begin our academic year, and with it the enjoyment of our newfound privileges as youngsters. First, we had moved to our new companies, 34th Company for me. This is so there would be no lingering resentment between upperclassmen and plebes. We could now roam the company halls in any sort of clothing we desired. No more full uniforms. We no longer had any lights out requirements either. We now had weekend TV privileges in the company wardroom. We also had town liberty, not just on Saturday afternoon, but Saturday evening and Sunday afternoon. Most importantly, we had one long weekend each semester. A long weekend. A weekend that would be considered a normal weekend at civilian colleges. Youngster year also introduced us to a new PT requirement, the obstacle course. This would now be added to the physical fitness test and mile run that we would be tested on each semester for the rest of our tenure at the Academy. There was one funny incident that had happened in the fall of our youngster year that I would like to refer to as the V-neck sweater episode. We were issued a Navy V-neck sweater plebe year. Do you happen to remember which uniform it was a part of? You were correct if you said none. As a result, it mostly lay useless in our clothes closets. That fall, some of the mids began wearing the V-neck sweater over the top of their working uniform to ward off the chill of the fall mornings. It was much more comfortable than wearing the reefer that would often be authorized as an option to wear. Soon many mids began wearing the V-neck sweater. It was perfect for handling the morning chill, but not too uncomfortable as the temperature rose during the rest of the morning. Plus, it was kind of preppy looking. The story goes that one day the officer of the watch stopped a mid wearing a V-neck sweater because of a dirty cap cover and was going to fry him. When the mid realized that the sweater covered his name tag, he simply took off running. The next day, An announcement was made in the mess hall regarding the new rule for wearing the V-neck sweater. The sweater could only be worn underneath your uniform shirt. The sweater was 100% wool. To wear it under your shirt would be very uncomfortable, not to mention that it made you look like the Pillsbury Doughboy. Although a few hardy souls tried to wear it, it was as prescribed, it eventually even they gave up wearing the sweater. As typically, the administration had overreacted, and for all practical purposes now they had banned the wearing of the sweater. The V-neck sweater returned to its place of uselessness in our closets, only to be resurrected one final time when it was allowed to be worn in lieu of our service dress blue jacket at a Gordon Lightfoot concert. Before we knew it, it was time again for the Army-Navy game. Here was my date for the game, my future wife, Terry. Navy once again broached the non-interference march-on agreement when a second-class mid donned a whoop uniform, marched onto the field with a corps of cadets, and once all the corps was on the field, stripped off his whoop overcoat to reveal his Navy letter sweater, and then ran to the Navy side of the field where he was greeted with applause and laughter by the brigade. It was not forecast to rain that day, so we were not required to bring rain gear. Shortly after the game started, it did begin to rain, and it continued to rain for the whole game. Our wool bridge coats acted like gigantic sponges for the rain, making everyone miserable. The game was once again hard fought, and this one went right down to the wire. We lost by 1 point on a controversial official's call as time expired. The sports analysts all agreed that the game official had erred, but of course there was no instant replay in those days. No Army B-rolled that year. But Navy did improve its overall win-loss record from the previous year to 3-8. A couple of interesting, memorable events occurred youngster year related to the Forrestal series. The Forrestal lecture series was actually started at the Academy during our plebe year in an attempt to broaden our perspective of world events. Roger Staubach spoke to us in the early spring. Roger was already a living legend, of course, for having been Navy's most recent and only second ever Heisman Trophy winner. And he had gained even more fame after becoming the starting quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys. He came to speak to us shortly after the Cowboys won Super Bowl VI, where he was also named Super Bowl Most Valuable Player. Here is a statement that he made that got a roar from the brigade. "Coach, just think, a year ago I was playing for the Pensacola Goshawks." I'm sure that gave Tom Landry a lot of inspiration. However, there was another speaker, actually two speakers, that came to the Academy a couple of months later that probably made an even more memorable impression on the brigade. Gloria Steinem and Dorothy Pittman were co-founders of the feminist magazine Ms. Gloria had become the face, and a very attractive one at that, of the feminist movement that had actively been lobbying the Chief of Naval Operations to allow women to enter the Academy. Gloria, on the left, spoke first. While I remember little what she said in her prepared remarks, I do vividly recall that at some point she referred to the Naval Academy as a white male ghetto, which was greeted with a collective groan from the brigade. After her prepared remarks, she entertained questions from the audience. I remember one firstie approached a nearby microphone and asked her out on a date. After the laughter subsided, Gloria told the firstie that she was not interested, but if she were, she would be the one asking him on a date, not the other way around. Her comment was greeted by another round of laughter as the firstie sheepishly returned to his seat. When it was Dorothy Pittman's turn to speak, she was visibly nervous. She began her speech by telling us that our attempts to intimidate her had failed. She then made reference to the oranges and apples that she saw in the audience. We had just come directly from the evening meal to attend the lecture, where orange and apples had been served at the meal. And many of us had taken those meals with us into the lecture. It took a minute for the brigade to realize that she was implying that the oranges and apples had been brought to the lecture specifically to throw at her. As that realization sunk in, chuckles began here and there, and eventually turned into a roar of laughter from the brigade. Mids then began bobbling their oranges and apples into the air to further mock her ridiculous comment. The watch staff was able to cease the orange and apple bobbling after a few minutes, and Miss Pittman resumed her prepared remarks without further incident. How could anyone have been so misinformed to think that an institution like the Naval Academy would tolerate anything be thrown at a guest speaker, let alone oranges and apples? Youngster year completed without further noteworthy events, and we donned our second-class insignia after the June week graduation ceremony. Here are some of the events going on in the world during our second-class year. I have highlighted the return of our Hanoi POWs, We'll talk about that in just a few moments. Our second class summer consisted of two distinct parts, pro-tramid and act-tramid. Pro-tramid consisted of 1 week long stints to Navy or Marine Corps locations to expose us to one of the four major warfare specialties that we could pursue after graduation. Pensacola for naval aviation, Newport, Rhode Island for surface line, Groton, Connecticut for nuclear submarines, and Quantico, Virginia for Marines. Hurricane Agnes had hit the East Coast in June of that year and would impact those of us who started pro-tramid right after June week. We experienced drenching rains in Quantico and rough seas at Groton. Our trip out on an attack submarine was actually cut short by one day due to the rough seas. ACT-TRAMID included academic work at the Academy consisting of shipboard tactics and speech classes, followed by a week-long YP cruise to Norfolk and then back. The purpose of the short cruise was to practice steaming in formations and responding to formation flag changes from the command YP. We returned to our company areas after Labor Day to start our second-class academic year. I think we now had a sense of professionalism as it sunk in that we were now officially committed to a service obligation. Any departure from the Academy at this point, either voluntarily or involuntarily, meant obligated service as an enlisted man. During plebeian youngster year, it was always in the back of our mind that we could simply walk away from the Academy and head into a whole new direction. That wild card was now gone. We now had weekday as well as weekend TV privileges in the company wardroom, though we did have to defer to first class for seats and TV channel selection. Once the first class tired of indoctrinating the plebes, it fell to us to complete their indoctrination. Most importantly, we now had two long weekends each semester. Finally, we had a new superintendent. Vice Admiral Calvert was relieved by Vice Admiral Mack in July. We would now have to adjust to a new personality at the helm. We would soon realize that this change was actually a good thing. Ever since plebe year, we had heard of the Cannonball Challenge. Cannonball was a nickname given to a dessert occasionally served in the mess hall, mostly in the fall, I believe. It consisted of a whole apple baked inside a pastry dough shell. The dessert was delicious, but it was aptly named because after eating just one, you felt like you had a cannonball sitting in your stomach. The USNA tradition for the Cannonball Challenge was that any plebe who could eat 12 cannonballs and leave the mess hall on his own power without getting sick would be secured from plebe year. One of our 34th company plebes announced that he was going to take on the challenge. We had seen a couple of plebes the previous year take on the challenge only to have to throw in the towel after consuming four or five. For the challenge, each person sitting at the plebe's table donated their cannonballs to the plebe. The plebe taking the challenge this year was a fairly small person, so at first not much attention was given to his challenge. As most of us finished our meal, we noticed that the plebe had already consumed cannonball number six. This got our attention. Mids from across the company as well as neighboring companies began to gather around and cheer the plebe on. At cannonball number 10, you could see he was struggling. He was taking long breaks between bites, and some of the bites had a hard time going down. By the time he got to cannonball 12, everyone was going crazy. Were we about to see history in the making? Amidst the go, go, go cheers from cheers he was receiving, he began cannonball number 12. It was definitely taking much longer to get each bite down for this one. He finally finished, though, that final cannonball, and looking very pale, he got up from his seat and began walking to the doors leading to the mess hall from the LA area. From the mess hall to the LA area. With each step, he walked a little faster until he was actually running for the last few yards to reach the door. As he reached the door, he pushed on the wrong door. It was the side that was already locked. Rather than moving to the other door, he just kept on pushing on that blocked door until finally he upchucked all 12 of those cannonballs all over the door. Technically, he had not completed the challenge successfully because he had not exited the mess hall before getting sick, but several upperclassmen, including me, spooned him anyway. What an incredible feat. I never saw any plebe ever get anywhere close to completing the challenge the rest of my time at the Academy. Here is a picture of a cannonball for those that may have forgotten. I found it on the internet. Of course, it wasn't called a cannonball, but that's definitely a cannonball. It was soon time for the Army-Navy game once again. This year, we were confident that we would avenge our one-point loss from the year before. Weather was not a factor this year. Navy started out well. By halftime, we were up 12-0. Even with the beginning of the third quarter, things were looking good. We were driving to score and increased the lead even further. However, we were stopped short, but still within field goal range from our typically consistent place kicker, Roger Lanning. Roger lined up for the kick, and then it happened. An Army defender not only blocked the field goal attempt, but caught it in midair and returned it for a touchdown. We were stunned. The score, of course, inspired Army. The whole momentum of the game changed almost immediately. Army suddenly became unstoppable on offense and seemed to thwart each one of our offensive drives. As the final gun sounded, the score was Army 28, Navy 15. Another year with no Army B-row. Navy was able to increase its season record to 4-7, though. And then we went home on Christmas leave and tried to forget about the Army loss. When we returned to the Academy after Christmas leave that year, we returned to a startling announcement regarding mandatory chapel. Since our plebe year religious service attendance was mandatory, we either elected to attend Sunday service at the chapel or at an approved in-town church service. A challenge to mandatory chapel by a West Point cadet and six USNA meds had been working its way through the courts. On 30 June, the U.S. Court of Appeals ruled that the mandatory chapel attendance at the three service academies was unconstitutional. On December 18th, the U.S. Supreme Court declined to review the Court of Appeals ruling. On January 2nd, Secretary of Defense Melvin Laird directed the service academies to change their regulations and to end mandatory chapel attendance. An era had sadly come to an end. A month later, we had good news, though. U.S. POWs held in Hanoi were coming home. Most of us had worn POW bracelets and plebe year to honor and remember our POWs held captive in Hanoi. Smoke Hall contained pictures of USNA alumni POWs and was another constant reminder of the sacrifice that they had made for our country. On February 14th, 18 days after the peace agreement had been signed in Paris, the first POWs arrived home. Returning POWs, especially alumni POWs, were invited to attend the academy and to the mess hall. They would come to visit a few at a time. Each former POW would be carried on the shoulders of plebes around the mess hall to the plaza of the rest of the brigade. Each time it was very touching. I don't think there was ever a dry eye in the mess hall during those occasions. We also had a most interesting event occur in the early spring of our second class year. I refer to it as the night the lights went out in Annapolis. Each spring, the Naval Academy hosted a Naval Affairs Conference, NAFAC. Dignitaries from around the world were invited to attend. One evening during the week-long conference, a special meal was held in the mess hall. During the course of that meal, the lights suddenly went out all over the academy. Temporary power outages were not uncommon at the academy, but this outage lasted for well over 30 minutes. What happened during those several minutes of darkness was unprecedented. First, fireworks of all description went off. Where in the world all those fireworks from within Bancroft Call came from, God only knows. Also, an unpopular company officer was given a black eye. Israeli dignitaries were in the mess hall, and their armed bodyguards feared that it was actually an Arab terrorist attack underway and reacted accordingly. The next day, all MIDs involved in any incidents that happened during the power outage were instructed to turn themselves in. Anyone later found to be involved who had not turned themselves in were to be subject to honor offense prosecution. The whole episode was a classic study in mob psychology from my perspective. Normal civil people doing uncivil things during unusual times. In 1973, a new fad had taken college campuses by storm. Streaking, running naked through the campus. I'm sure we never expected to experience streaking at the academy, but we did. In the spring of 1973, good old USNA would witness its one and only episode. One of our 34th company youngsters had submitted his resignation from the academy and was just a few days from being discharged. During lunch one day, while the brigade commander was reading the announcements, a naked young man appeared at the top of the steps leading from main hall into the mess hall, disguised with women's pantyhose pulled over his head. He ran the length of the mess hall and exited out the doors leading to the LA area. Unfortunately, one of the academy employees would see him, identify him, and turn him in. The youngster was required to restrict for an entire week rather than just a couple days that he thought he had remaining before being allowed to finally be discharged and go home. I am sure that is not what the young man thought would happen to him. However, he does lay claim to making history. We completed second semester, and it was time for June week. This was a special time for us because it was time for our ring dance, the event marking the point that we could officially don our Naval Academy class rings with the USNA crest on one side and our 74 crest on the other side. We had actually selected the stone to adorn our ring, as well as the choice of either gold or white gold for the content of the ring earlier in the year. In those days, the spot price of gold was around $100, making the average price of our class rings around $200. I wonder what the class rings cost today with the price of gold over $1,000 an ounce. The ring dance was actually preceded by a special dinner in the mess hall for us and our dates. Here is the menu for that meal. Each couple also received a little remembrance booklet that described the ring dance tradition. Here is the cover of the booklet and a couple of the pages from the booklet. Here is a picture of me with my future wife inside the Academy ring mock-up, which were used for the official ring dance photos. Notice my ring around her neck on a ribbon. The dance was actually held outdoors in the area between Michelson and Chauvenet Halls. That, of course, was a risky call for such an event, but the weather was perfect. Duke Ellington and his band provided the music. This was one of the last appearances of the Duke, as he was to pass away in the May of the following year. Before entering the dance, it was tradition for our date to dip our ring into a compass binnacle containing the rings containing waters from the seven seas. This was supposed to bring good luck. Here is a picture of that ring dipping ceremony. The ring dance overall was indeed a memorable event. With another graduation complete, we now donned our first class insignia and became top dogs on campus. Let us take a final look at the world events during our first class year. All in the Family was still the top TV show for the fourth straight year. How many episodes of that did we see in the company wardroom? You will notice the price of gasoline sneaking up as well. However, the big events for the year centered around political corruption, the resignation of Vice President Agnew, and the ongoing Watergate investigation implicating President Nixon. First class provided us a variety of choices. We all went on a first class cruise. For some, it was selecting an LPD cruise like we had gone on youngster year, but this time serving in junior officer billets. Others had chosen an individual ship for their cruise. Still another choice was to go aboard an aircraft carrier for a shortened cruise, followed by serving on the plebe detail. I chose the aircraft carrier cruise plebe detail option. I was immediately upon graduation week sent to join up with the USS John F. Kennedy in the Mediterranean, where I was assigned to an E-2 Hawkeye squadron. During plebe detail, I served as company subcommander. I have to admit that I had chosen this option not out of any insatiable desire to help mold the new plebe class, but rather to be able to spend more time with my soon-to-be fiancé who lived in Silver Spring. I have to admit, plebe summer was much more fun as a first class. We returned to our company areas after Labor Day to begin our final academic year. We had been told at the conclusion of the ring dance, at the conclusion of second class year, that the administration had decided that the first class and second class had become much too chummy, and a decision had been made that the first class would be the ones to move. Our company moved from 34th Company to the 8th Wing, from 34th Company in the 8th Wing to 18th Company in the 7th Wing, where we had been plebe year. We, of course, now ran the brigade from a midshipman organizational perspective. We were the stripers. We had unlimited long weekends, only interrupted by those weekends when we had the company weekend duty section or had been assigned to watch duty for the weekend. We received our paycheck in total. No monies were held back to be deposited into our midshipman account fund, as had been done in past years. More money to spend while enjoying those long weekends. We owned the company wardroom, meaning that we determined what TV channel would be watched and were always guaranteed a seat. Most importantly, we were allowed to have cars on campus. And finally, a new change had been made, giving those of us 21 or older the privilege to be able to partake of alcoholic beverages while in Annapolis on Liberty, as well as make use of the Naval Academy Officers Club on Friday and Saturday evenings. Definitely an Academy first, and something that would never have happened under Admiral Calvert, I'm sure. Speaking of pay, here is a copy of my Midshipman Monthly Pay Statement. That $302.95 sure seemed like a lot more money back then, didn't it? I can't remember the precise date that we were finally given permission to bring our cars on campus, but I believe it was sometime in late September. The date for this was something that was always a negotiation point between the brigade commander and the commandant. I guess our first set brigade commander, Doc Savage, had done well in negotiating since we were able to do this in advance of the homecoming game. What a feeling that was to have that privilege. I can remember just going out during that first free period during the first week we had our cars on campus and just sitting in my car and listening to the radio. Remember the low interest rate loan that was made available to us to be able to buy our first e-cars, that whopping $3,000? Here are some pictures of the 18th Company first e-cars. I'm sure this is fairly representative of what could be seen in other companies as well. They range from the sporty to the full size, to the very sporty, the vets, to the classic, and to the midsize. If there was one first-class car that was undoubtedly the envy of all classmates, though, it had to be the car that belonged to our 18th Company classmate, Scott Davis. It was what I would term the ultimate first-class car. It was a Ford Pantera. Its price tag was at least double that of a Corvette, I believe. The car just looks fast sitting there, doesn't it? However, soon after we had our cars, a world event occurred that would alter our driving styles dramatically, the Yom Kippur War. On October 6th, during the Jewish observance of Yom Kippur, the Arab states launched a surprise military offensive against Israel. Israel prevailed, but not without massive assistance from the U.S. Immediately after the hostilities ceased with the Arab states, they imposed an oil embargo on the U.S. as a retribution for our aiding the Israelis. The price of oil shot from $1.56 a barrel to $11.56 a barrel, causing the price of gasoline to rise from an average of 40 cents to over 55 cents a gallon within a span of just a few weeks. Worse than the price increase, though, was the limited availability of gasoline. Seeing signs like this posted in a gas station was not uncommon. We now had to carefully plan our driving excursions from the academy, not knowing where we could actually find an open gas station to fill up with gas. Despite the gas shortages, we adapted and moved forward. Soon it was time for our final Army-Navy game. Our classmates now held all key positions in the team. During one of the pep rallies that week, there was a shout to go over the wall. Such a shout had happened in previous years, but had never really been initiated. However, this time we spilled out into the streets of Annapolis, with those of us over 21 heading to the bars downtown. That was the only pep rally that I can recall where the administration seemed to condone going over the wall. Here's a picture of Admiral Mack joining us in with the festivities at one of the bars out in Annapolis. I'm sure this never would have happened under Admiral Calvert's tenure, would it? The weather for the game was cloudy and very cold, but at least there was no precipitation. Navy took an early lead, and it soon became clear that Navy was dominating both sides of the ball. By the third quarter, it was obvious that Navy would emerge the victor. Coach Wells put in the second team, and still we kept scoring. By the fourth quarter, the second string had been replaced by the third string, and still we kept scoring. Coach Welsh finally mandated that every remaining offensive play would be a running play to help run out the game clock, and also to prevent any unnecessary further scoring. The final score, as you see here, was 51-0. The game still holds the record for the largest margin of victory in the series, although the 2002 game would come close. The win also earned Navy's first possession of the Commander-in-Chief's trophy in its second year of the trophy's existence. Overall, Navy was 4-7 for the year, and it meant a second Army B rope for those of us who had ventured to wager that bet. I wonder if they even have such bets these days, given Navy's strings of wins over Army these past years. Before it was time to head home for Christmas, there was one more very important piece of business for us to take care of. service selection. In early December, it was time to choose our naval career path. We waited in our rooms with anticipation as each range of class standing numbers was called out. When the range containing our class standing number was called, we headed down to Smoke Hall to select the branch of the Navy that we would serve in for at least the next 4 years, or perhaps even 40 years. Here is a picture of the first group of our classmates making their selection. Smoke Hall was like a three-ring circus with a different part of the hall dedicated to each of the branches, Marine, Surface Line, and Naval Aviation. Those electing nuclear power had already gone through a selection process with Admiral Rickover earlier in the year. For those selecting Surface Line, there was a list of ships with available ensign and assignments. As the open billets for a particular ship filled, the ship would be removed from the available list. For those selecting Naval Aviation, there was a two-step process, selecting your class start date at Pensacola, and then selecting a temporary duty assignment that you would report to while awaiting your flight school start date. In previous years, there had been a quota placed on the number of first class who could select Naval Aviation as a Naval Flight Officer. For our class, the quota had been eliminated. As a result, well over 40% of our class selected Naval Aviation, either as a pilot or Naval Flight Officer. I was a part of that group, selecting to be a pilot. Matter of fact, 16 of the 27 members of 18th Company chose Naval Aviation. At the conclusion of the evening, our futures had been cast. The return from Christmas leave, completion of first semester finals, and start of our second semester just seemed to fly by. For those of us who had become engaged, a great deal of second semester was spent with our fiancés finalizing wedding plans for a June week wedding. As May approached, our cruise boxes arrived. For the past 3 years, we had watched as other first class assembled their cruise boxes and then set them outside their rooms. The box was used to send personal belongings to their home of record upon graduation. It was a rite of passage. And now it was us assembling those crew boxes. It was now our visible rite of passage. Our days of midshipmen were coming to a close. Our last semester finals were soon completed, and it was now time to once again enjoy June week, our June week. It was a good feeling to see Tecumseh painted with our class number, wasn't it? There were many June week activities that now had a special meaning just for us. There was the farewell ball held in Dahlgren Hall that had just completed renovation that changed it from the armory into a visitor center with an ice skating rink. Here is a picture of a couple of fine-looking classmates with their fiancés at the ball. For the June week concert that year, James Taylor appeared. There is a bit of a story here. James Taylor had recently married Carly Simon, and the couple had recorded the song Mockingbird as a duet, and the song was rapidly rising in the charts. It was rumored that Carly often accompanied James on his concert tours and would sometimes join him to sing. About halfway through the concert, Carly was seen in the wings of the stage. Soon after, the audience began to chant, "Carly, Carly," each time James would complete a song. With each song completion, the chant grew longer and louder. You could see that James Taylor was visibly getting upset by the chanting. Finally, James had had enough. He started a song and then abruptly stopped. He looked out into the audience and chastised us, saying something to the effect that we had paid to come hear him sing, and if that was not enough, then those people should just leave. An embarrassed hush fell over the audience. We were collectively humiliated by our rudeness. No one left the auditorium. James continued the concert. When he completed and the audience clapped vigorously for an encore, James graciously brought Carly up onto the stage and they sang Mockingbird, much to everyone's delight. Then it was time for our last formal P-raid on Warden Field. The weather was nice and sunny, but not too hot for early June. Perhaps it was just such a refreshing feeling knowing that it was our last P-raid that the heat didn't even seem to matter. After the P-raid, we went directly to the reflection pool for the traditional jumping into the water still attired in our P-raid uniform. It was an academy uniform that would never be worn again, so it mattered not if it got ruined. I am told that our class was the last class to celebrate this tradition, as the reflection pool was to be filled in over the next year as part of renovation plans at the academy. Even our fiancés joined into the reflection pool dip. Wednesday, June 5th arrived, and it was time for us to graduate. President Richard Nixon was to give the graduation address. Nixon's popularity at this point had dropped to an all-time low as a result of the Watergate investigation and revelation of their criminal wrongdoing and presidential involvement in its cover-up. Impeachment by the House was considered an almost certainty. Here is a picture of the protesters outside Navy Marine Corps Stadium on the morning of graduation. The graduation stage had actually been rearranged out of concern for the president's safety. And as a result, one half of the stadium could not be occupied. Each graduate was limited to the number of tickets as a result. President Nixon and his wife arrived by helicopter. The graduation ceremony went forward without incident. I remember nothing about what the president said during his address. After he completed it, the honored graduates were individually called to the stage and received their diplomas. A representative from each company was then called to the stage to receive his diploma on behalf of his company. Here is a picture of me doing the honor for 18th Company. Each company did some little gimmicky thing to try to distinguish themselves from each other company at this time by letting balloons go, blowing party favors, etc. 18th Company decided to bring homing pigeons in a paper bag and release them. As I took to the stage to receive my diploma, I gave a hand signal to release the pigeons, and off they went. Nixon seemed to be amused by the pigeons. He shook my hand as the pigeons flew overhead, and he said to me, "Very original, young man." After the diplomas had all been handed out, President Nixon swore us in as new ensigns and second lieutenants. We were now officially alumni, all 918 of us. And we did our traditional hat toss into the air. After the ceremony, we did our ceremonial donning of our ensign and second lieutenant rank, and then began our active duty careers, however long they may be. So here we are in 2014, 40 years later. Our last classmate on active duty, Admiral Mike Miller, just retired after his tour of duty as superintendent of the academy this past July. Talking about coming full circle, huh? Some of us are still working at civilian careers. Others are fully retired. Some are even doubly retired, both from active duty and subsequent civilian employment. But even those of us still in the workforce know that full retirement is just around the corner. We have gathered at class reunions several times over the years, just as we will again this fall. At each reunion, we look a little more wrinkled, with a little more gray hair, and for some of us, with a little less hair. With each reunion, we have paid respect to those classmates who have departed us. It seems like we are getting notified by emails from our class president much too frequently these days of another classmate's passing. 23 in the last 5 years, I understand. I guess we have reached that stage in our lives when our other destiny will soon call us. I think we all know that we have experienced something very unique at the academy. My best friends are all from the class of 74, and I'm sure many of you feel that way too. I found this quote from the 1973 Lucky Bag that I think very well sums up our class experience. A class is not merely friends, but rather an organization that is filled with people, places, things to remember all of the days of our lives. It should not just be recalled, but distinctly remembered. Over the past 40 years, we have gone in different directions all across this great country and even across the world. It is understandable that we may not have stayed as connected as we should have liked. I have a challenge for you, though. Please make a pledge this year to reach out to each of your surviving company mates and those classmates that you had a distinct bond with at the academy but have seemed to have lost touch with. Wish them a happy birthday. Send them a Christmas greeting. Or just call to say hello and to say that you remember them. Please distinctly remember them. Now and each subsequent year. God bless, stay connect, and beat Army. Larry out.